See, suffering enables us to discover whether our Christian life is built on mere words or on a living relationship with God. You know, we speak of trusting God. Of course, we do. What about God trusting us? Because in this situation too, God is trusting Job with his reputation, God's reputation.
Imagine your journey, immerse your senses, ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a trip of a lifetime that celebrates all things Israel. From November 17th through to the 27th, 2016, join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we explore Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, you'll visit Via Dolorosa, the Mount of Olives, Beit She'an, Caesarea, Mount Carmel, and many more amazing destinations. Ignite your faith. through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hilary Price and special guests during a two-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
I'd like to personally invite you to join Hilary and myself for a wonderful and rich experience in the land of Israel in November 2016. We're calling this trip Awaken 2016 Israel. Whether this is your first trip to Israel or you're returning with us to this beautiful, significant country, imagine a journey where you'll immerse your senses and deepen your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Most of the key events in Scripture took place in the land of Israel. And we'll visit places whose names have probably been familiar to you for many years. We'll be fascinated by the historical sites and events and be able to soak up spiritual significance that is associated with them. This is a vacation like no other. You'll enjoy the sights, sounds, and great food of the Holy Land, as well as wonderful warm fellowship with like-minded travelers. And we've set aside ample quality time to refresh and rejuvenate the spirit. Towards the end of our journey, we'll stop and take time in the Word of God together. Hilary and I will teach at a two-day haven of reflection in a private venue right on the shore of Lake Galilee. Our hope is that we may encounter the living Christ and come away in a deeper relationship with Him. Awaken 2016 Israel holds the potential to invigorate us physically, to enrich us socially, and to refresh us spiritually. Like many who have journeyed with us before, you may come home knowing you'll never be quite the same again. Don't miss this opportunity. Please join Hilary, me, and the Living Truth family on this exciting journey. We hope to see you in Israel in November 2016.
Save these dates, November 17th to the 27th, 2016. To reserve your spot now, visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time. Why do bad things happen to good people? Is our trust in God enough to get us through tough times? Today's message is called Making Sense of Nonsense.
Now I'm going to read this morning from the book of Job and chapter 42, which is the last chapter of the book. We have spent six Sundays looking into the book of Job. That is an inadequate amount of time for a book that is 42 chapters long. But I'm sure you're very glad that we have not done what Joseph Carlyle, who was a 17th century minister, did. He decided that he would teach from the book of Job and found it so intriguing and fascinating that his series lasted for 24 years. He would take a detour at Christmas and Easter and things like that, but the regular Sunday by Sunday, he took 24 years to go through the book of Job. And be grateful that that's not me. But I do want to read this last chapter to you this morning, chapter 42, which brings many of the loose ends that have been there in the book of Job, brings them to as near to tying them together as we possibly can do. And we can't do that as tidily as we'd like to, probably. But Job 42, it says, "Then Job replied to the Lord, 'I know that you can do all things, and no plan of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my counsel without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me. My ears had heard of you, But now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. After the Lord had said these things to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, I'm angry with you and your two friends because you've not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has. So now take seven bulls and seven rams and go to my servant Job and sacrifice a burnt offering for yourselves. My servant Job will pray for you, and I'll accept his prayer and not deal with you according to your folly. You have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has. So Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite did what the Lord told them, and the Lord accepted Job's prayer. After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord made him prosperous again and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought upon him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. He also had seven sons and three daughters. The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Keren Hapuch. Nowhere in all the land were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters. And their father granted them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children down to the fourth generation. And so he died old and full of years. If you've been here, you'll know that the book of Job is built around a challenge that Satan gave to God. And the challenge was, does Job fear God for nothing? The reason for the challenge was that God had set Job up to Satan as an example of the best of men. It said back in chapter 1, verse 8, the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. They don't come better than Job. Job was successful from every angle at which you would look at him. Spiritually, he's described as blameless and upright. He fears God. He shuns evil. Materially, he owns 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 donkeys. Had a large number of servants. Emotionally, he had a secure family with a wife and his seven sons and three daughters. Physically, he was healthy and strong. And Job was doing so well that God said, there is no one on earth like him. He is exhibit number one. How are you getting on with him, Satan? You're going through the earth doing as much trouble as you can. How are you getting on with Job? Satan's answer was, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not built a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You blessed the work of his hands so his flocks and herds are spread to the land. But if you stretch out your hand and you take away the hedge and everything he has comes under attack, that man will curse you to your face. Job only fears God because life is good for him, says Satan. That's why you use him as the example. God said, all right. Very well then, said the Lord to Satan, everything he has is in your hand. On the man, do not lay a finger. On the man himself, in other words, okay, we'll take the hedge down and we'll see what Job is really made of. Job knew nothing of this. Job was happily getting on with his life, oblivious to all this behind-the-scenes conversation that we're told took place between God and Satan. And suddenly he woke up one morning and wham, bam, and things began to fall apart in his life. His oxen were all stolen and his servants were killed, bam, and then his donkeys were taken off, bam, and then his camels were taken off, bam, then his sheep were all destroyed, bang, his servants, most of them died. And worst of all, the biggest catastrophe was his sons and daughters having a part in the eldest son's house. Were all killed when a hurricane flattened the house. But Job stayed true through it all. His response was, the Lord gave, the Lord take away, may the name of the Lord be praised. And so then the challenge is put again to God by Satan. Does he fear God for nothing? You said don't touch his body because you knew that that's what he's really concerned about. You give him physical pain and he'll squeal. God said, all right, touch his body. And he lost his health, had to sit in an ash heap, scratching himself with sores from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. His marriage went south. His wife turned against him. She told him to curse God and let him finish you off. She no longer wanted to be close to him because he gives us some unnecessary detail, but she couldn't stand the smell of his breath. Probably his sickness had created unhealthy breath. And Job began to wish he had never been born, wonder what is the point of my life. And if all of that wasn't bad enough, some friends came along, Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar, and then followed by a fourth younger man, Elihu, and they came to comfort Job, but all they did was tell Job that something must be wrong with you. That's why these things are happening. What is it that's wrong, Job? Look deeply into your own heart and repent of it, and then God will put things right. And Job said, I can't think of anything that could be wrong. And they said, that's a lie, Job. Think harder. And they gave him chapter after chapter after chapter after chapter of this kind of condemning counsel. And then after 38 chapters, God spoke. He spoke, it says, out of the storm. We looked at that last week. And he doesn't speak about the sufferings of Job, interestingly. All he speaks about is himself. We have the nearest thing to an autobiography by God, of God, in those few chapters. Talks about the things he does, the things Job knows that he does, and so on. And now in Job 42, Job has six verses to make sense of all that he's been through. And that's followed by a short epilogue. It tells us what happened afterwards and how that Job had everything restored to him and lived happily ever after and died a very old and very satisfied man. That's how the book finishes. I'm calling this today, Making Sense of Nonsense, because there's so much all the way through that just does not make sense. And I want to point out three things that we can learn from this, that Job implies in the short response of six verses that he makes. First of all, look for the unexpected. In other words, don't make life so predictable that this will happen and the good thing and follows will be that and this will be the good thing. But look for the unexpected. He says in verse 1 and 42, Job replied to the Lord, I know you can do all things and no plan of yours can be thwarted. What's the unexpected ingredient here? God has a plan in this. He doesn't know about what's gone on before in the discussions in heaven. But now he sees that this is not just a satanic attack that is random or purely at Satan's discretion, but behind it all, the providence of God was present and at work. And so he says to God, no plan of yours can be thwarted. But what was the plan? Well, we have to try to work that out for ourselves. He doesn't explicitly tell us. And we can form a few conclusions. I want to offer you two at this point. One of the things we learn from this is that suffering and many of the mysteries of life that we don't understand accomplish a divine purpose. Now, it's hard for us to enthusiastically embrace that suffering and accomplishes a divine purpose. But in the counsel of an all-wise God, an all-knowing God, an all-powerful God, an all-loving God, he is bringing something good out of things that are bad. Over our lives is someone who cares, someone who loves, someone who, in these seeming accidents of life, can work out a purpose. And I've quoted that verse a number of times. I think it's so important in this kind of instance. In all things, God works for good. The things may be evil, the things may be wrong and bad. But God never says, well, that wasn't my plan. Oh boy, what's going to happen now? They're on their own. No, that was not my plan. And there are many things in this world that are not the plan of God or the will of God. But in them, God works something different to what was there before, but he works something out that is going to be good. It is true, you see, as 1 John 5:19 tells us, that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. It is true, Satan is called the prince of this world on several occasions. It is true that the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is not work, and those who are disobedient, is a description of Satan in our world. It is true that Satan is cohorts, or called in the New Testament, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. The devil is active. The devil is able in many areas. But don't ever think that the devil and God are equal, somehow fighting it out on a level playing field. God is the creator. Satan is created, created as we saw earlier in this series, as a beautiful angel. And Satan has a high role in cosmic affairs. Clearly, these titles he has given tell us that. But Satan is also limited. God had to give him the permission to do what he did. And he did give permission. He does allow us to come under attack like that. But God is never outwitted by his activities. And when suffering comes to an innocent person, it need never be wasted if we recognize that God works for the good of those who love him. Satan may originate these evil things, but God operates in them to bring about good. When I was a boy, one of the big events was the martyrdom of five missionaries in Ecuador. My father used to pray for one of those missionaries. He used to get his prayer letter, newsletter. There were five American missionaries gone down to Ecuador, and they were trying to reach a group of people who had been completely isolated from the modern world. They'd flown over in a little plane. Nate Saint was the pilot, and they'd dropped presents and tried to let them know they were friendly, and eventually landed the plane on a sandy beach on the side of the river, and it was going to be their first encounter with these people. And they were speared to death, all five of them. The missionaries had guns for their own safety regarding wild animals, but they never drew them. All the guns were locked in their holsters. These men speared them to death. And there was a great search. There's a gentleman who normally sits over here who was involved in the initial search to go and find them, Dr. Roberts, back in those days. And I remember hearing it on the radio, and I remember it initially because of the shock factor in my father, because he knew the name of one of them in particular. The news became headline news around the world. All the media, newspapers picked it up, and they talked about the waste of five young, capable, well-trained young men who could have succeeded in probably whatever profession they'd chosen to go into. They were all married. They all left young widows. They're all in their late 20s. One or two, I think, in their early 30s. One of the wives, Elizabeth Elliot, the wife of Jim Elliot, and the sister of Nate Saint, Rachel Saint, within weeks went back into that very area to try and continue the work their husbands had begun. Knowing all the risks, going against all the advice, don't do this, this is dangerous, you're women, in any case. But they began to lead people to Christ. Nate Saint's son, Steve, who has spoken from this platform, was baptized in the river in which his father died by the man who actually killed his father, because he came to Christ, he'd come to Christ. And we have the son of that man also here on this platform about 10 years ago now, telling us that story. It was a tragedy. There's no question the devil's behind the onslaught and the attack and the murder of those men. But out of it, God did something very, very beautiful that's still going on today. And they estimate that about 10,000 people went to the mission field as a result of that martyrdom, because it impacted them so deeply. And I think that would be a very conservative number, because I have met people on mission fields all over the world, and when you say, why did you come here? One factor I have heard many times is because I read the book about those five men in Ecuador and the impact they had. God is not behind the murder of five men like that. That is an evil act. But he's never outwitted. And there are things in your life and things in my life, we see the fingerprints of Satan on them. They're not good. They're not wholesome. Maybe some are even self-inflicted when we disobeyed God and followed the satanic temptations. But even there, God comes to redeem and bring something good, something better out of it. So suffering accomplishes a divine purpose. And a second comment on this is that suffering can be a test of spiritual reality as well. That was the real test. Is Job real? Is he authentic? Is what is seen about him coming from an absolutely genuine place in his heart, or is it simply because life is good for him, it's easy for him to trust God and to worship God? That was the real test. And what proves our lives to be genuine is suffering. Peter writes in 1 Peter 1, verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes, even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. So this is why you suffer, says Peter. This is why you can rejoice in your suffering, because it'll prove you're genuine, will expose that you're phony. You see, suffering enables us to discover whether our Christian life is built on mere words and creeds or on a living relationship with God. You know, we speak of trusting God. Of course, we do. What about God trusting us? Because in this situation too, God is trusting Job with his reputation, God's reputation. Because Job is exhibiting before Satan, who Job doesn't even know is watching, that he's not serving God for his own selfish benefit. He's serving God because God is God and he's in love with God. And when a man or woman is gripped by the reality of God in their lives, by the reality of his love for them, of his presence with them, and his purpose with them, all hell can be let loose. And they stay real, because that is more real than any of those things. Now, this makes sense for a verse in the New Testament in Ephesians 3 and verse 10. Paul wrote, his intent was that now through the church, that is through his people, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Through the people of God, the wisdom of God is made known to these principalities and powers in the heavenly realms, these satanic, demonic forces. Because God demonstrates that within the reality in our own lives. Job is exhibit number one before Satan. This man is real. And you know he's real because he didn't quit when things became tough. In fact, he became even more deeply driven into God as he acknowledges at the end. So that's the first thing, three things I'm going to give. I always make the first one longer because time runs out. But the second thing is live with the unexplained. Look for the unexpected is the first thing. That there is a purpose going on here. Look for the unexplained, secondly. I take this from verse 3, where God asked him, you asked, who is this that obscures my counsel without knowledge? You know, who's this talking nonsense they don't know anything about? And Job's response is, surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. My problem is I tried to work out what I cannot understand for the simple reason they are too wonderful for me to know. They're much bigger than what I anticipated, much better than I anticipated. And, you know, we have to make room in our minds for the unknown and leave that room as the unknown. Things that we want to work out, but which we cannot. I think a key chapter in Job is Job 23, and I'll just read you part of it, verse 8, where he says, if I go to the east, God is not there. If I go to the west, I do not find him. When he's at work in the north, I do not see him. When he turns to the south, I catch no glimpse of him. Where is God, Job, in your life? I don't know. East, west, north, south, I look in every possible direction. I don't know where God is, but, he goes on to say, but he knows the way that I take. I may not know where God is, but God knows where I am. And when he has tested me, I will come forth as gold. Not garbage, not trash, broken and useless. But I don't know where God is in this, but he knows where I am. And the result of this, says Job, I know, is he's going to produce gold. Gold comes through a melting and a refining process. As Psalm 66, verse 10 says about silver, it says, for you, O God, tested me. You refined us like silver. Same process. Isaiah 48, verse 10, see, I have refined you, though not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction. See, gold has to be tested and refined in the furnace. And real spiritual wealth is the gold that God produces through that refining fire that enables us then out of that experience, difficult though it may be, to be able to bless other people. We've got some currency to pass around that blesses people because God has done something in our own hearts, in our own lives. It doesn't always turn that way, by the way. You can become very bitter in suffering as well. You become a bitter person who only has negative things that come out because of the suffering. Or you can become like gold, bitter or better, under this process, same process of being put into difficulty and hardship. But Job goes on to say, I'm still then Job 23, where he says, I don't know where God is, but he knows where I am. He's bringing forth gold. He then goes on to say that he has his part to play. He's not just a passive participant. Job 23, verse 11, he says, my feet have closely followed his steps. I have kept to his way without turning aside. I have not departed from the commands of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my daily bread. I'm not just sitting passively back. I am closely following him. I have kept to his way. I have not departed from his word. I treasure the words of his mouth more than my daily bread. He didn't have a Bible, but we do, and we have the Word of God. And in those situations, this is where you feed your soul, and you treasure it, and you find in it your strength and your comfort and your encouragement. And he finishes off there. He carries out his decree against me, and many such plans he still has in store. Notice, not many such problems, but plans. Corrie ten Boom, who lived through a number of years in a concentration camp during World War II and whose books have encouraged so many people, she says, God doesn't have any problems, he only has plans. And what seem to us problems are to him plans. And it's like a tapestry where we see the underside with all the seemingly tangled threads that don't make a lot of sense, whereas God sees the top side. He sees the beautiful picture that is formed by all these seemingly meaningless threads, which only we can see. John Wesley wrote, the readiest way which God takes to draw a man to himself is to inflict him in the area that he loves the most, because nothing shows him more clearly the emptiness of what he considers lovely and desirable. As a third thing, look for the unexpected, live with the unexplained, and allow there to be in your life, without any embarrassment, an unexplained box of mystery. I don't know the answers to this. I just trust God in this. And thirdly, learn the undiscovered. What I mean by that is in verse 5 and 6, and this is a key to Job's final response. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. There's a big difference between his ears hearing and his eyes seeing. What I knew in theory, he's saying, I now know in experience. Because we can have heard it all, and we can know it all, yet experience very little. We can be theologically literate, but spiritually barren. We can dot our I's and cross the T's of our doctrines, and yet have no substance in our actual lives. And over all this process through the book of Job, I can't find any evidence of Job's beliefs about God changing at all. His beliefs about God were correct, it would seem. I'd heard of you. I'd heard well of you. I'd taken note of what I'd heard. I believe what I heard. But now my eyes have seen you. Now what I believed has become life in a way it never had before. It became experiential in a way it never had before. You know, it's easy to place our faith in what God does, and we trust God because he does certain things. You often hear people, say, I believe God for, and then they have their request is like writing on the check what they believe God for. We have to come to that point where we simply say, I believe God, period. What he would do is his business. I believe God with no agenda that follows after that, other than what he has promised me. And we often interpret God's protection of us as the evidence of his love. So when we feel that we're not protected in all kinds of ways, whether major ways or relatively minor ways, we question him. Our faith is not in what God does. Our faith is in who God is. I think I've told this story a little while ago when I was in England on one occasion leading a family conference. And a couple of nights we had an open time of testimony from people who were part of this conference, and I was leading it, and one man got up and he told us how that his two-year-old son had run out of the front door of the house, which had been left open, onto the street, and a bus was slowing down to stop at a bus stop, and it hit the child. He ran in front of this bus, knocked him over, and the child was on the ground as the full length of the bus passed over him, and he got up and ran back into the house. He was bruised, and he was crying, but nothing more than that. And this father of this boy told us the story and said, "Thank God with us for his love and his protection of us." And so we did, of course. We thank God. We had a few people praying, thank God for saving this little boy. A few minutes later, I noticed a lady there with her husband. She got up and she left room at the back. And a few minutes later, her husband got up and he left as well, presumably to go and find her. Later, I saw them. It was a residential conference, so we're all around. I saw them and I said to them, "Are you okay? I noticed you left the meeting." And they said, "We lost our young son this year." They said, "It was wonderful to hear how that little boy was not injured or killed by the bus. And we thank God for his love and protection on them. But does God love us? Is he protecting us when our son died?" It's a question that came from deep, deep hurt and confusion. And there are no pat answers, except, does God love a person in this situation? The answer is yes, absolutely he loves. Is God protecting us from all these things? The answer is no. He doesn't protect us. But our faith has to be beyond in what God does, to who God is, irrespective of what he does. That's why when God spoke those four chapters, he does not explain Job's suffering. He doesn't say this is the end purpose of it. He simply talks about himself. Who made this world you're part of, Job? Who made the skies? Who put the constellations into place? Remember we looked at that? Who made the crocodile? Who made the hippopotamus and all these animals he mentions? And he says, okay, Job, that's it. Job had to go away and think, well, yes, who made the stars? Who made the world? Who made these strange animals? Is he capable of caring for me? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. The danger when we have good experience, and we thank God for good experience, is our faith rests in the goodness of that experience. But there are times God will leave us with nothing but God himself to cling to. And that's when we will grow significantly. God rebukes the comforters. Job tells them they've said the wrong things, tells Job he must pray for them. And it's interesting, he told Job to pray for his friends, not his friends to pray for Job. Job was the one who's in need, but he says, "You, Job, you pay for your friends." I don't know why, but I would suggest because the friends would have prayed very predictably that God would take away all Job's troubles and put him back on the map again. And Job wouldn't pray that for them. Job would pray for them that they, whether they see him or not, will trust him. And then one last thing, and we finish. When I see a movie that is based on a true story, I always enjoy the lines at the end, just before the credits, that says, so-and-so went on to do this or do that and live to be 98 years of age, and his legacy worked through to this and that. You know those little lines at the end that you love to read and know what had happened next? Well, there's a few lines like that here, the 8 verses at the end that tell us what happened when all this was over. And it's intriguing. Job got everything back, doubled. He had 7,000 sheep, now he has 14,000. Used to have 3,000 camels, now 6,000. Used to have 500 yoke of oxen, now 1,000 yoke of oxen. Used to have 500 donkeys, now he's got 1,000 donkeys. His brothers, his sisters, his relatives, his friends, who had all deserted him, came back to eat and drink with him and give him gifts. And it says, the Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the first. And he had 7 more sons and 3 more daughters. And to cap it all, nowhere in all the land were there found 3 women as beautiful as Job's daughters. He really hits the jackpot. Everything doubled. Beautiful daughters. By the way, the only thing that wasn't doubled was his children. He had 10 before, he's got 10 now. I wonder why they weren't doubled. Well, I'm sure Mrs. Job had something to do with that. But I'll tell you just a little thought. It may be because the children will be the only thing that outlive this life. And in heaven, Job will have 20 children, the first 10, united with the second 10. And I picture Mrs. Job like the little old woman who lives in a shoe with so many children, she wouldn't know what to do. Job lived until he was 140, long enough to see his great-great-grandchildren. They were as prolific as he was. Just take 10 children now. They all had 10. That's his grandchildren. That's 100. Next generation, they all had 10. That's 1,000 great-grandchildren. He lived to see his great-great-10,000 descendants if they multiplied on that rate, but his name was not Rabbit, it was Job. We don't know how many grandchildren. One last question, all of our minds. Aha, so Job's comforters were actually right. They said, if you are right with God, he will bless you and multiply everything. Well, at the end of the book, it looks as though they're right, doesn't it? God's blessing is seen in material prosperity, but the answer is no. That's already been established in the book. That is not the measurement of God's blessing. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. It's totally his prerogative to give. It's totally his prerogative to take away. If he gives, be responsible for what he gives. If he takes it away, be responsible with what you don't have. That's the message, and trust him. And for you and for me this morning, if you're doing well, thank God for his blessing. Thank him you have food on your table today. There's 1 billion people in the world who will not have food on the table today. Wonder where that food will come from. If you have resources that are more than enough, be grateful for that. Don't be guilty about it. Be grateful. But maybe you know, there'll be an interview going on in heaven behind the scenes about which you know nothing. And God may say to Satan, how are you getting on? I'm doing okay. Have you been to Toronto lately? Yes, I have. Do you know so-and-so? Yes, I do. He's doing pretty well, isn't he? Yeah, that's because you built a hedge around him. Really? That's why he loves you. That's why he's in People's Church every week. I mean, life's good for him. Okay, take the hedge down. Take it down. You won't know it's coming. I won't know it's coming. But when it comes, as you trust in him, you'll be able to say, as Job says, when it's through, my ears have heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. What I knew was true, I now experience. Why? Because I've been through the valley of suffering.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Next week, Charles Price begins a new series on Living Truth called James, Just Do It. Why do bad things happen to good people? Is our trust in God enough to get us through tough times? The series, Job, From Tragedy to Triumph, explores our relationship with God when trials and tragedy strike. This series, by Charles Price, is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. God can speak to us out of the storm and move us closer to Him.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given. Jesus as Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given. Jesus Christ, His Son.
And now let we say, I am strong. Let a poor say, I so what the Lord has done for us.
And now,
let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done. He's given Jesus Christ, His Son.
Give thanks
with a grateful
heart. Yes, we do. We give Him thanks
to the Holy One. Give thanks
because
He's given Jesus Christ.
His Son.
And now
Give it thanks. Every face.